And you guys are welcome here, too. Good morning, New Hope. It's great to see you all this morning. Thanks so much for joining us here in the church there, watching us online. Thank you guys for being a part of our service today. Why don't we all stand? We'll make a joyful noise today. Off we go. The battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you.
We sing out today.
So when I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. See the beauty. When all I see is a cross, God, you see the empty tomb. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, and I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Almighty folks.
And almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And almighty fortress, Lord, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. 'Cause you shine in the shadows, and you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. God, we thank you that no matter what we face, whatever situation, whatever circumstance, we thank you that you are in control and the battle belongs to you. Lord, we ultimately just need to step aside and let you be God. So we want to do that today, Lord, no matter what situations or circumstances we're facing. We thank you that even in a world that seems upside down, you're the one who can set it right. And we trust you to do that today. And
whatever we're facing, we know that the battle belongs to you. So God, use this time to meet us here, inhabit the praises of your people, and move on our hearts in a powerful way today, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, New Hope. All right, I wasn't awake at first either, so good morning, New Hope. All right, if you are new here, welcome. We hope that you will look in the seat back in front of you. There is a card that you can either scan with your phone camera and be able to fill out the form online, or you're welcome to fill out the back of the card and turn it in the back box there. That's also a great way to update your information, send out prayer requests, and let us know if there's a ministry you want to be involved in. Next week, we have a potluck, and as previously mentioned, there is a sign up in the back that it's actually there this time. Okay, we just want to know if you're going to bring a main dish, a side. Dessert is covered because the youth are going to fundraise by selling desserts. So please bring a couple dollars, and you can purchase some ice cream. So no desserts, main dishes, side dishes, salads, anything like that. If you forget to sign up, we still want you. We're just trying to get an idea of who's bringing what so we can, the leadership team can bring the extras. There is no theme this time. Last time we had 4th of July, so we had the pulled pork, but this time, please, you are welcome to bring main dishes as well. Kids Ministry is throwing an ice cream social on August 7th at 11 a.m. This is an awesome opportunity to come and meet your children's ministry leaders, get to know them a little better, especially if your kids are being bumped up to the next class this next school year. We encourage you to come. There's a lot of fourth graders that are moving to the fifth grade class next door. We did just split into small groups, and we have some new leaders there. So we super, super encourage you to come 11 a.m. on the 7th here in the fellowship hall. Exciting, exciting news for our women. Okay, we have a women's retreat this year, October 1st through the 3rd. Yes. Okay, we are going to go to, it's called Rock Creek Ranch Retreat, and it is about an hour away. I don't know the area. I'm still new. I've been told mountains that way. About an hour. Okay. we're going to go visit up there, so I'll have a few more details. I'll understand location a bit better. But it is $200 a person, and that includes food and board. And there, I know that this is last minute. We are only doing a $50 deposit for it, so you'll still have until September 19th to make up the rest. You can go online by end of day and click the link on the front page or women's page or in your app. It will be up and ready to go by end of day today. $50 deposit, total of $200 due by September 19th. There are only 30 slots. We thought that would probably be enough for this year. We're hoping it is. If we need to expand next year, we will. But if you're really wanting to go, please sign up right away so that we know you're coming. And there are a couple scholarships available. If that $200 is going to hold you back, please talk to Taylor, I, or Jennifer Dimitrov, and we can hopefully arrange a scholarship for you. We want you to come if you want to come. Just a quick reminder that we did switch giving systems a couple months back, and there has been some people that are like, oh yeah, I'm good, and then they go check and nothing's actually happening. So just a reminder to check your app or check online, check your bank account. Make sure that's actually happening. If it's not and you're confused about it, come talk to me. I'll be out in the foyer in the fellowship hall and it can help you get that set up. The best way to do it really is the app. It is quick and easy. Next week we'll have a little instruction video to help you out as well. Last but not least, we are starting our Sunday team meetings. Our plan today was to do security at 1 o'clock and AV at 2 o'clock. The security team has been canceled, and it is my child's fault. Back there, yep, his fault. We had an electrical cut through a cord yesterday, so now we're waiting on an electrician instead. So I apologize, the security team meeting is canceled today. We will meet during this week. But the AV team is still on the production. So if you're interested in helping in the back at all, please come at 2 o'clock today. And a quick reminder that next week's is 1 o'clock is landscaping and 2 o'clock is the treasury team, including the money counters. And these meetings are going to be vital to getting our teams cohesive and working and growing and just expanding our capabilities. So please come if you are part of these teams or interested in these teams. And that's everything. Back to you, Jeff.
That was a lot. Great job. Great job. Come on. Come on. Give it up. Flawless execution of the announcements this morning. Hey, so during a time of worship, feel free to sit or stand, whatever you're comfortable doing today.
Maker of all things new, all of my hope is in you. Even when I can't see past this time, I believe you will see me through. And I lift my eyes to the hills, desperate to find your will. As water surrounds and I'm sinking down, you speak to the waves, be still. Your light will shine and break through the darkest night, and I will praise you, my Adonai. And in time, ashes of beauty will rise, you hold the only key for the chains holding on to me. Every day I believe by faith, you're the one who can set me free. And I can believe your word, trusting in all that I've learned. Help me to be waiting eagerly, longing for your return. Your light will shine and break through the darkest night, and I will praise you, my Adonai. And in time, from ashes of beauty will rise,
your light will shine,
your light will shine, break through the darkest night, and I will praise you, my Adonai. And in time, from ashes of beauty will rise shout as your praises resound. I will dance, I proclaim your glorious, wonderful name. I will sing, I will shout as your praise. Play
worship as your praises resound. I will dance, I will praise your glorious, wonderful name. I will sound
as your praise.
See past this time, I believe you will see me through. I believe you will see me through. And how I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity.
There will be a day.
There will be a day when all will bow before. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. And every prayer we prayed in desperation, the songs of faith we sang through doubt and fear, and in the end we'll see that it was worth it when he returns to wipe away our tears. There will be a day when all will bow before him, and there will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. And on that day we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith, and with one voice a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And on that day we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith, with one voice a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Forever he shall reign.
that once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at His feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty, the radiant of perfect love, now shines for all. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Fear that held us now gives way to Him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive in me. Cause your name is big. Spirit, I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me, and in your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit, I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me, and in your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. Soldiers watched in vain, was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. We sing it out today. Our God has robbed the grave. Your name is victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. And your name is victory, and all
resurrected King,
the resurrected King is resurrecting me.
Yeah. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, New Hope.
Morning.
All right, let's go ahead and pray. Thank you, Father, for providing all things, for giving us everything we have, and everything is yours to begin with. Jesus, help us to see both you as Lord and Savior, to know that you are the only one who can and will save us from eternal death. Thus, leaving us with an attitude that is grateful and full of joy, serving you in humble obedience, in truth, and in love as our King. We pray for you to prepare our hearts for your truth, just as a farmer prepares the soil for good seed to be sown. Father, we pray for you to give Dennis the words to speak, that it would not be his words, but yours, to give to your people and to the ones you are calling. We thank you for those that you have put in our lives, our families, our friends, and all those around us. Help us to love them as you love us, even when we were still your enemies. All of our hope is in you, King Jesus. Give us peace and patience as we eagerly await and expect and desire your return, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, we welcome you to dwell among us this morning, to stir the hearts of your people. All for you, Lord. All honor and glory and power to you forever and ever. Amen. Scripture reading from today is Nehemiah 1, 1 through 10. Reading from the ESV. The word of Nehemiah, the son of Hakalai. Now it happened in the month of Chislev, in the 20th year, as I was in Susa, the citadel, that Hananiah, one of my brothers, came with certain men from Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews who escaped and who has survived the exile and concerning Jerusalem. And they said to me, the remnant there in the province who has survived the exile is in great trouble and shame. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates are destroyed by fire. As soon as I heard these words, I sat down and wept and mourned for days, and I continued fasting and praying before the God of heaven. And I said, O Lord God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer of your servant that I now pray before you day and night for the people of Israel, your servants, confessing the sins of the people of Israel, which we have sinned against you. Even I and my father's house have sinned. We have acted very corruptly against you and have not kept the commandments, the statutes, and the rules that you have commanded your servant Moses. Remember the word that you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the peoples. But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though your outcasts are in the outermost parts of heaven, I there will gather them and bring them to the place that I have chosen to make my name dwell there. They are your servants and your people, whom you have redeemed by your great power and by your strong hand.
serving the king. He never said he was he was never sad. His confidence has never fallen. He was always kind of in a good mood. You kind of want to be that around an all-powerful king, right? You don't want to look too sad. You want to keep everything good. And so he had always been in a good mood, Nehemiah had, but on this occasion, the king noticed something's a little off. So the king says, what's going on? And so Nehemiah gets the opportunity to explain to the king exactly what is happening back in Jerusalem. He explains that this is where he's from, these are his people, and the walls of the city that he loves are broken down. And so the king grants, catch this, Nehemiah permission to return to Jerusalem. He was praying that God would show him favor in the eyes of the king, and that's exactly what happened. The place where my father's tomb is, Nehemiah said to the king. So he says, go back, go rebuild. Not only does he tell him to go back and rebuild, he even, catch this, he even provides the material for it. How amazing is God's providence in this? Kings don't usually do stuff like this. He returns to Jerusalem, Nehemiah does, in 445 BC with the appropriate royal letters. It's kind of a passport, if you will, permission to pass through the region. And he walks into Jerusalem and he inspects the city secretly. He doesn't announce to everybody, hey, I'm here, it's party time. He just quietly goes about looking at everything, assessing everything, seeing what needs to happen. And then, once he's done with that, then he meets with the leaders of Jerusalem and proposes to build the wall, to rebuild the wall around the city. And the officials, there are some officials in the neighboring areas around them who don't like the fact that they want to rebuild the wall. They are insulting the Jews. They are accusing them of wanting to rebel against Persia, trying to incite the king against them so that they cannot rebuild the wall. And these enemies even planned attacks against Jerusalem. And at one point tried to have Nehemiah killed. But their rebuilding begins in spite of the opposition. Chapter 3. The walls of Jerusalem and its gates are rebuilt by the Levites and the priests and the Jewish people all working together. The chapter lists the sections of the wall that each person built, who built them. And by the way, one of the genius ideas that Nehemiah had, probably from God, is the idea that each person, in order to motivate them to build the wall, because it's a big project, nobody wants to get to work. So he says, I'll tell you what, you'll be responsible for building the section of the wall right by your house. How's that for motivation? And they're like, okay, I'll do that, right? I want that section strong, okay? So often the houses were built into the wall or part of the wall. And so he said, you're responsible to build that section of the wall that you live by or next to or in. And so they began the rebuilding process. They began the rebuilding process. And of course, they began rebuilding in spite of all the opposition. And in the midst of all the opposition. Now, chapter 4, guy by the name of Sanballat, he's a Horonite, and Tobiah, he's an Ammonite. They mock and ridicule the Jews as they try to rebuild Jerusalem's walls. Nehemiah prays that God would defend them against this. Sanballat and the others are angered when the walls are nearing completion. They're getting angry as the walls are getting closer. And they plan an attack. And the Jews prepare the defenses. Nehemiah tells the people to station guards at all times. So while one person is guarding, the other person is building. In fact, even the people that are building are guarding. They got a sword in one hand and bricks in the other, right? And so there is a defensive plan. They develop a defense, a clear defense. And so each person's building close to their house. They're thwarting off the attacks. The Jews prepare the defenses and arm themselves. People stand guard against the attackers as the wall is being built. And of course their plan of attack is thwarted. Chapter 5. So Jews, we see, have mortgage their houses because they're so poor that in order to eat, they have to mortgage their houses and borrow money in order just to pay the taxes that are being levied upon them from the regional governors around them. Some Jews have become so poor that they actually have become slaves to other Jews because of their financial difficulty. And Nehemiah calls for a meeting. And he says, listen, this is wrong. into the safety of the newly rebuilt walls. Chapter 8, Ezra reads the law to the Jews in Jerusalem. So Nehemiah tells Ezra, hey, these people need to learn the word of God, because many of these people had never heard the word. They were exiles. And they had teachers on hand to help explain the implications of God's word for their lives. The Jews worship and they weep and they celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles, or the Feast of Booths, as it's also called, which is, they've neglected this, by the way, ever since the time of Joshua. This is the feast and celebration of God's continual provision of them for the current harvest, to remember his provision and protection during 40 years in the wilderness. So they're, in other words, they're getting back to the way that things are supposed to be, back to obedience to God's word, back to being moral people, good people, people that obey the word of God. Chapter 10. Actually, no, chapter 9. Chapter 9, the Jews gather, separate themselves from pagan foreigners that are influencing them to do all kinds of evil things. They hear the history of God's work read by Ezra, all the way from creation, Adam, Abraham, deliverance from slavery, God's faithfulness in the wilderness, their rebellion and exile. They fast, they confess their sins. They don't hide them. They confess their sins. They repent. They read God's word, and they make a covenant with God, a commitment with God. They recommit to faithfulness to him. Chapter 10, the leaders and the people sign a covenant. They actually sign a covenant. It's more than just, I'm going to say this, more than just I'm making a covenant. I'm actually going to sign something. And they make an oath to remain unstained by the world around them, by the influences around them, to be faithful, to obey God's word. Chapter 11, Jerusalem is repopulated by all the leaders and about one-tenth of the people, and the rest live in the surrounding cities around Jerusalem. The distribution of people is decided by Lot in chapter 13, and lists the people. Chapter 12 lists the names of the priests, the leaders of the people in Jerusalem, along with their temple duties, and the priests and the Levites. The new wall of Jerusalem in chapter 12 is dedicated. There's a huge party. It's marching and music and food and sacrifices to God, and people give generously. And then there's one last chapter, and that's chapter 13, and I'm going to leave that one for the very end. So I want you to keep the story in your mind so far. We'll leave chapter 13 for later. Now I want you to note something right here. I want you to note the fact that Nehemiah is not a professional priest. He's not a king. He hasn't gone through any formal training or seminary, or he doesn't hold any official title within Jerusalem or anything. He's what we would call a layman. A layman. Someone that's part of God's kingdom, part of the brotherhood, but he has no other position. He's a layman. And in all that Nehemiah accomplishes, remember that he was not professionally trained. He's not some pastor or priest or anything like that. He's just a guy. A guy that God called to do something great for him. And he took up that charge. He took up the charge, and he began to work. What is God calling you to do? Is God calling you to do something? You say, well, I don't have a degree. I'm not a professional. I'm not a pastor. I'm not a deacon. I'm not an elder. I'm not a... You know what you are? You know what the Bible calls you? You're a saint. That's how the Bible refers to Christians. You're a saint. You're a servant. Okay? What's God calling you to do? Now, before their exile, God's people or what you claim to believe? The book of Nehemiah centers around the people's need to develop a defense. They needed to develop a defense not only against the external threats and the external influences of the people surrounding them by building a wall. They also needed to develop an internal defense against their own moral weakness that was corrupting them. They needed to develop a defense not only against internal threats and influences, but against their own moral decay. We are messed up people. I don't know if you knew that. At New Hope here, we often say we're all messed up in our own special way. That's how you know you're a New Hopian. Me first. We're all messed up. But Nehemiah was passionate about building the wall. Why? Nehemiah was passionate about building the wall because he knew the people needed to develop a defense against physical external forces that could destroy them, but he also realized that people needed to develop a defense against spiritual forces that wanted to destroy them from the inside out, often. So Nehemiah's focus in his ministry was ultimately spiritual. Sure, he built the physical wall, but it's about spiritual. Did you know that that's how things always work? Just because you see something doesn't mean that's the real thing. There's a spiritual thing behind it. Like, we have a building right now. It's all around us, right? Well, the church is not about the building. Any one of us who's been to church any length of time know that that's not the case. This is not the church. You're the church. This is just a building. But buildings often represent things. And just as the wall represented their need to be separated from the world around them, so Nehemiah also understood the spiritual reality that they also needed to develop defenses against sin from within. So, in the book of Nehemiah, we see some clear strategies for you and I as to how we can develop defenses against spiritual forces that are at work to destroy us. Can I tell you something? There's a being known as Satan, and his desire for you is nothing more than to see you utterly destroyed. If he can get you to compromise and walk away from God, oh, he'll be as happy as a clam. That's his whole purpose in existing, is to get you to walk away from God, to live in hypocrisy. And so, in the book of Nehemiah, we see some clear strategies for developing a defense against our enemy who prowls about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Forces that could destroy you, both from without you and from within you. And these strategies that we see in Nehemiah are just as relevant for you and I today as they were back then. You say, what are these strategies? We're going to dive into them. We see several principles portrayed. We see several practical principles portrayed in Nehemiah. First, we see the confessing of guilt. You remember that when we began talking about Nehemiah? The first thing he did is what? Confess before God his own guilt and the people's guilt. He said, hey, we're all messed up, Lord. We need your help. He confessed guilt. He confronted sin head on. He didn't water it down. He didn't make light of it. He confronted sin head on by confessing his own sins and that of the people. He didn't rationalize it. He didn't excuse it. He didn't justify it. He didn't make light of it. He didn't water it down. He called it what it was. He recognized the severity of it, and he confessed it. Confessing our guilt is a means for developing a defense. Confessing all together. I mean, after all, I'm not a bad guy. Certainly not compared to the guy next to me. I haven't killed anybody. I don't steal. Well, not much, not usually. And I don't really, you know, do anything wrong. Maybe I speed a little bit. But really, I'm a good guy. Believe me. That's what we think. But what God sees is something different. God sees us for who we really are. God sees our sin as weighty. He doesn't measure us by our yardstick. He doesn't measure us by the yardstick of our neighbor. He measures us by his holy yardstick, right? His righteousness and purity. So we don't rationalize sin. We confess our guilt. Confessing our guilt helps us to develop a defense against self-righteousness. When we recognize our sin, something happens. We do as Nehemiah did. He faced the problem head on, and he made specific plans to correct the problem immediately. What's the application to ourselves? Well, the first step to recovery, the first step to recovery is what? Admit you've got a problem. You can't help someone that has a problem unless they admit they have a problem and they say, I want help. This is how it is, okay? It's just reality. So the first step to recovery is to admit that you've got a problem, confessing our guilt. Admit you've got a problem. Admit it to who? Well, you could start by admitting it to yourself, because until you admit it to yourself, you're not going to want to admit it to anybody else. We start by being brutally honest with ourselves. We see ourselves for who we are. We see ourselves in honest light, right? We don't touch up the photo. We don't do the Photoshop thing, right? We don't look at ourselves as a Facebook selfie, right? We look at ourselves as how we really are, right? In the cold light of truth. And so we recognize our depravity. First, we have to confess our guilt to ourselves. Recognize our problem. Next, to God. And sometimes it requires to others. Sometimes it's a healthy thing, you know that, to confess to others. To be able to stand up and say, hey, we're all messed up in our own special way. Me first. It's a good thing. James chapter 5, verse 16 says, therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be what? Healed. Isn't that an interesting passage? What does it say to be healed? Confess your sins to one another and pray for one another. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Proverbs chapter 28, verse 13, whoever conceals his transgressions will not prosper, but he who confesses and forsakes them will obtain mercy. Psalm 32, 5, I acknowledge my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Acts 3:19, repent therefore and turn back that your sins may be blotted out, that times of what? Refreshing may come. You want times of refreshing? You want a season of refreshment in your life from the presence of the Lord? Repent. Confess. Key principle in developing a defense. Confessing our guilt. Number one, you want a defense against the spiritual forces set out to destroy your life? Start with confessing your guilt. Next, number two, confessing our guilt, committing to God. Committing to God. Commitment is a word that we do not like today. Someone asks us to make a commitment, we run the other direction. We don't make commitments. We don't like to make commitments. It's like that guy that's been engaged to that girl for the last 10 years, you know, and you ask him about, so when's the big date? And they're like, well, never. Or I don't know. Or, and you're like, what are you waiting for? Well, I don't know. I just don't want to commit, man. What does that mean? What kind of message is that sending her? Well, you don't want to commit because why? Because you want a way out. That's how it works. We don't like to commit. We don't like to sign documents. We don't like to sign covenants. We don't like to sign agreements. We sure don't like to commit to anything. But we are supposed to be people who are committing to God. Nehemiah encouraged those involved to go on public record stating that they had decided to change their ways, and a promise was made before the people and before the God, and before God publicly. Committing to God, you say, what does that have to do with developing a defense? Committing to God helps us develop a defense against what? Apathy and indifference. Apathy and indifference. Confessing our guilt helps us develop a defense against self-righteousness. Committing to God helps us develop a defense against apathy and indifference. Did you know that there are so many people out there that say, yeah, I'm a Christian, if you ask them? And then you look at their life and it's like, what evidence is there? Like if this were taken to a court of law and somebody tried to prove with evidence that you're a Christian, would you win that case? Commitment to God helps us develop a defense against living with apathy and indifference towards God's kingdom and God's will and God's glory. Because we're not supposed to be that way. Nehemiah realized that God wanted desperately to bless his people, just like God wants desperately to bless us. Did you know he wants to bless you? But that he would only do so if they remained faithful to him. You say, how do you know that? Glad you asked. Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 5. Lord God of heaven, you are great and fearsome, Nehemiah says, and you, catch it, faithfully keep your promises to who? To everyone who loves you and obeys your commands. Loves you and obeys your commands. You ever notice how those two often occur in Scripture? Do you ever notice that loving God and obeying his commands are like this? Do you know what Jesus said? Jesus said when, on one occasion, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. If you love me, you will keep. Isn't that funny how that's God's test, like if you love him? Oh, you say you love me. That's really good. Let's check that out, shall we? If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Did you know that a relationship with God is not about doing right and wrong or keeping a set of rules or rituals or regulations that religion teaches you? It's not about that. In fact, you can't do anything by your own merit or your own works to get one inch closer to God. You can't live good enough or think good enough or be good enough or give enough or anything to get an inch closer to God. What a relationship with God is all about is, do you love me? But if you love me, it will show by what you do. It's like Janet Jackson, right? What have you done for me lately, right? It's true. It's the theology of Janet Jackson. I mean, I'm telling you, Jesus has got it down. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. It's all, because here's what God wants from you in the end. You know what he wants? He wants the same thing that you good fathers out there want for your kids. Think about that. What do you really want from your kids? Do you want them to keep their room clean and brush their teeth in the morning and comb their hair and do all their chores and get good grades in school? You're like, yeah, okay, that's great. I mean, sure, that's okay. But really what I want for them is to love me. And I love them, and we have this beautiful, wonderful relationship. And then everything else just kind of is just tangential, right? Guess what? That's what God wants for you. He wants a deep, intimate, close, personal relationship with you, not some distant God that you meet on a Sunday morning for 50 minutes. Well, here for, you know, 95 minutes or something. But normally, God does not want that kind of thing. He wants an intimate, close, deep, personal relationship with you. A loving relationship which requires something of you. That means you have to love him. You have to love him, and you show it by keeping his commands. You don't get saved by keeping his commands. You don't get closer to God by keeping his commands. You get saved through the blood of Jesus Christ, and you show that you're in a relationship because you love him, and that's demonstrated by the way you live and keep his commands. Okay, moving on. Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 5. Lord God of heaven,
Oh, I'm sorry, I already read that one. Matthew chapter 3, verse 8. I'm tracking. Bear fruit in keeping with repentance. Remember how we just talked about confessing and repenting, right? John the Baptist said to the people that are coming to him, you bear fruit in keeping with repentance. In other words, don't just make some show of it. Don't just come here and get baptized. Please stop. Don't do that. Unless you're going to bear fruit in keeping with repentance. What does fruit have to do with anything? Well, fruit is the analogy of that which grows on a tree. You know a tree by its fruit. Exactly. Okay? So you can take an oak tree and take an apple and try to tape it to it, right? It's not going to change it. That's the same thing like you trying to do good enough and be good enough and give enough and think good enough and whatever enough to earn God's righteousness. You can't do that, to earn God's favor, his merit. You can't do that. You can't tape apples on an oak tree, but you do recognize a tree by its fruit. So bear fruit in keeping with repentance. Commitment is essentially a component of what we love. What we commit to is what we love. And it is necessary to commit in order for any lasting change to take place. You want a fresh start, you better make a commitment. You want something new, something different, you better make a commitment. You know, when you get married, you're making a commitment, right? That wedding ceremony that you have and you exchange those rings, I mean, the rings don't mean anything, they're just a symbol of the commitment that you made. Same thing with baptism. When you get baptized, you're not just getting wet. There's no magic in the water. There's no salvific efficacy in there. It doesn't somehow save you. What it is you're telling the world, hey, I have made a commitment to Christ. It's like a wedding ceremony. Have you made a commitment? Are you committed to God? Are you bearing fruit in keeping with repentance? See, true commitment to God can only come from a true, genuine love of God. Same thing like a true commitment to your wife or husband can only come from love. It's not about some legal document. It's love. And love isn't always that squishy, mushy feeling. Usually, love is a choice, a decision. In the good, in the bad, when it gets rough, when it gets hard, you stick it out. You people that have been married, you get it, right? It's not always roses, right? It's a commitment. And out of love, I commit to you. Matthew 22:37b, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. Here's what God wants from you. You want to know what he wants from you? Here's what he wants. Listen. You shall love the Lord your God. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. What are you supposed to do with your heart, soul, and mind? Love the Lord. Wow, I didn't know Christianity had so much to do with love. I thought it was all about doing stuff and being better and giving more. No, you missed it. It's all about this. This is the what? First and greatest commandment. You don't get this right, just stay home. Stay home. Hey, you can sleep in on a Sunday morning. It's cool. You can sleep in longer. Don't make the mistake of thinking that rules and rituals and regulations of a religion are going to get you closer to God. This is what it's all about. You shall love the Lord your God. And when you love him, you're ready to make a commitment to him. James chapter 4, verse 8, draw near to God and he will what? Draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you who are double-minded. Man, I could go on for 2 hours about that. I'll skip it. Proverbs, you're welcome. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 through 6. Trust the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding in all your ways. In everything you do and everything you think and your purpose for everything and your reason for living, in all your ways acknowledge him and he will make your paths straight. Whew. Confessing our guilt, committing to God. You say, what else is there? I want to tell you before we leave this, nothing significant, hear me on this, nothing significant will ever, ever, ever happen in your life without your sincere commitment to it. commitment. I don't care what it is. I don't care if you have your as your goal, you want to have some career, this is what I want to be, or I want to lose weight, or I want to, whatever it is. Until you make a commitment to it, you're just talk. You're just talk. So if someone asks you to commit to something that you say you're passionate about and devoted to and that you love, and you're like, I don't think so. Well, I guess we know what we got, don't we? Okay, moving on. Next. Keeping our guard. Nehemiah talks about keeping our guard. Just as Nehemiah developed a defense for those building the wall by posting armed guards continually, he also warned the people to keep guard against sin in their lives. He knew how easily small, little, tiny, seemingly insignificant compromises can eventually destroy the best of good intentions. You ever experienced that in your life? You ever gotten into a relationship in your life or a situation in your life or a job in your life? You had the best of intentions, man. This thing is going to be awesome. I do a lot of marriage counseling, and I always ask people, hey, can I ask you something? When you got into this and you were standing there on that wedding day, you know, did you ever think it would come to this? They're like, never. Nobody ever stands there and says, you know what, this is going to really stink. We're going to hate each other. We're going to be arguing over finances. We're never going to see each other. I'll be in my room playing video games, and she's going to be out with the ladies. Nobody ever thinks that way. Somehow we end up there. How do we get there? Here's how. We didn't keep guard. We didn't keep guard. Just as Nehemiah developed a defense for those building a wall, he realized they needed to develop a defense for their spirits. Keeping our guard helps us develop a defense against what? Keeping our guard helps us develop a defense against compromise in our lives. Because compromise is killing you, man. Compromise is killing you. It's why you have a difficulty, and I have a difficulty sometimes, being successful in things. One, we don't commit. And then when we do commit, we compromise. We compromise on the commitment. We don't keep guard. You say, how did that marriage end up messed up? I'll tell you. We compromise. Little things. Oh, little things. It doesn't have to be a big thing. You don't have to go to Vegas and blow everything of all your spouse's money, right? You don't have to have some huge torrid affair with 50 other women. It doesn't always work that way. Sometimes it's just the little things. Sometimes it's just the little things. Nehemiah realized that a strong wall that they had just completed was completely useless if the city gates were left open to attackers. He set guards in place with clear instructions designed to prevent enemies from having an easy opportunity to get in. Oh, it's always one enemy at a time. It's usually not the hordes. It's just one guy and two guys and three guys, and then pretty soon you're messed up. Nehemiah chapter 4:9, and we prayed to our God and set guard as a protection against them day and night. Day and night. So they set a protection. Day and night. How often do you have to be on guard? Day and night. When can I let my guard down? I got news for you. Never. I'm trying to think of the saying. Eternal vigilance is the price of freedom. That's it. Eternal vigilance is the price of freedom. You can never let your guard down. That's the answer. Similarly, if we allow the gates of our lives, our eyes, our ears, our thoughts to remain unguarded, then we're inviting the enemy. We're inviting Satan to come in. We need to develop a defense. We need to be holy. We need to be set apart from all the corruption in the world. I'm not talking about being separate from people. I'm not talking about you never talk to the sinners. Quite the contrary. You go out of your way to talk to sinners. Jesus went out of his way to hang out with sinners. What I'm saying is you don't allow yourself to be corrupted by that. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, be sober-minded, be watchful, watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Romans 12, 2, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Psalm 141, 3 and following, set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. That thing that gets me into trouble all the time. Keep watch over the door of my lips. Do not let my heart incline to evil, to busy myself with wicked deeds. You ever find yourself in that place? You got a little spare time. What do you busy yourself with? In company with men who work iniquity, let me not eat of their delicacies. 1 Corinthians 15, 33, do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. Oh, but I can take it. I'm strong. They're not going to influence me. Yeah? Bad company corrupts good morals. This is how we end up in messes in our lives. Messes. This is how we make train wrecks of our families. One of my favorite bands, for any of you who know me for any length of time, is a band by the name of Casting Crowns. Love them. Fantastic. If you don't know them, look them up. Listen to their stuff. They have a song. They have a song. And the lyrics go like this, and I want you to listen to it. Couldn't be more true. Be careful, little eyes, what you see. It's the second glance that ties your hands as darkness pulls the strings. Be careful, little feet, where you go, for it's the little feet behind you that are sure to follow. It's a slow fade when you give yourself away. It's a slow fade when black and white are turned to gray. Thoughts invade, choices are made. A price will be paid if you give yourself away. People never crumble in a day. It's a slow fade. Be careful, little ears, what you hear. When flattery leads to compromise, the end is always near. Be careful, little lips, what you say, for empty words and promises lead broken hearts astray. The journey from your mind to your hands is shorter than you're thinking. Be careful if you think you stand, you just might be sinking. It's a slow fade when you give yourself away. It's a slow fade when black and white have turned to gray. Thoughts invade, choices are made, a price will be paid if you give yourself away. People never crumble in a day. Daddies never crumble in a day. Families never crumble in a day. It's a slow fade. Keep our guard. Proverbs 4:23. Keep your heart with all vigilance. For from it flow the springs of life. Put away from you crooked speech, and put devious talk far from you. Let your eyes look directly forward, and your gaze be straight before you. Ponder the path of your feet, then all your ways will be sure. Do not swerve. Do not swerve to the right or to the left. Turn your foot away from evil. These are warnings. These are God's warnings for your life. Philippians 4:8, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Think about these things. Matthew 5:27, you have heard it was said, you shall not commit adultery. This is Jesus. But I say to you, everyone who looks on a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. You see the principle there? It's about what's inside. Job 31:1, I have made a covenant, back to commitments, I have made a covenant with my eyes. How then can I gaze sinfully on a woman? There's a saying, you sow a thought and you'll reap an action. You sow an action, and you'll reap a habit. You sow a habit, and you'll reap a character. You sow your character, and you will reap your destiny. See, it's a slow fade. We have to, church, we have to get to the point, I want all of us at New Hope to get to the point where we fully grasp the fact that happiness is holiness. We all want to be happy. I get it. There's nothing wrong with wanting to be happy. In fact, God wants you to be happy. Just get it. Happiness is holiness. It's not compromise. It's never compromise. Last. You want to develop a good defense, you better know your guide. Knowing our guide. Confessing our guilt, committing to our God, keeping our guard, knowing our guide. Nehemiah knew that if change was to last, it must be ultimately guided by a higher source of truth. You just can't come to a place and make some impassioned speech and go away and expect everything to be groovy. It's not going to happen that way. They needed a higher source of truth. He recognized the importance of God's word and knowing God's word from the inside out. And it showed in his approach the people's spiritual renewal. Why is it so important that we have a thorough understanding of God's word? Like, if you claim to be a Christian, can I ask you, don't answer aloud, just answer in yourself, what kind of depth of understanding do you have about God's word? Think about that to yourself. I mean, here is, if you're a believer, the very words of God himself, which you claim to live by. Are you at all vaguely familiar with it? Things that make you go, Why is it so important that we have a thorough understanding of God's word? Well, I'll tell you three things very quickly. One, human beings are fickle. If there's anything I know about people, human beings are fickle, man. We swear we're going to do one thing one moment, and next minute we're running 180 degrees in the other direction. People are fickle. Our sense of right and wrong, our own yardstick we use to measure ourselves and the people around us, our sense of good and evil is, here's a theological word for you, messed up. Okay? Messed up. Why? Because it's subjective. You can see it not only in yourself and the people around you, you can see it in society. Look at what society accepted 50, even 20 years ago. Look what it accepts now. People are fickle, baby. We change like the wind because we have no objective standard. Everything's subjective. It's what I think. And what I think today is different than what I thought 10 years ago. God is unchanging. His word is unchanging. We need an objective sense of morality. Two, it serves as a defense against the lies of this world because this world is filled with all kinds of stuff. Whatever the latest thing is, whatever the latest philosophy is, whatever the latest thing that's popular on social media or whatever, it serves as a defense against all the lies that are out there. And it serves as a defense against self-righteousness. You know how cults get started? Because people don't know the truth. That's how cults get started. Because people aren't founded and grounded in the Word of God, and some slick-talking salesman comes along and sells them on whatever he wants. That's how cults get started. That's why the world's filled with messed-up religions. Three, the Word of God is powerful. Powerful. And it equips us for being able to live holy and righteous. Knowing our guide helps us to develop a defense against deception. Knowing our guide helps us develop a defense against deception. Proverbs 21:2. Every way of a man is right in his own eyes. Like, find me someone who thinks that the way they generally live is messed up. Like, usually most people, I don't care if you're a serial killer, he'll explain to you why and justify how and why he had to kill those 12 people. It was only right. Every man's way is right in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the heart. Don't trust your heart. It's deceptive above all things. scripture says. Hebrews 4:12, for the word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing the division of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Man, you need scripture. You need scripture as an objective source of truth. Psalm 119:160, the sum of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous rules endures forever. While Jesus was praying to his Father for his disciples, did you know what Jesus said? He's praying to his Father for his disciples, and he said this, John 17, I do not ask you that you take them out of the world, but that you what? Keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. You want to be sanctified in truth? God's word is truth. Deuteronomy chapter 11, what does God want from you? You shall therefore lay up these words of mine in your heart and in your soul, and you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes, and you shall teach them to your children, talking of them when you're sitting in your house. Do you do that with your children? You shall teach them to your children, talking of them when you're sitting in your house, when you are walking by the way, when you lie down, when you rise up. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. You want to get serious about this whole relationship with God thing? This is it. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 32. And now, O sons, listen to me. Blessed are those who keep my ways. Hear my instructions and be wise. Do not neglect it. Psalm 119:105. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath. Back to the oath thing. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it to keep your righteous rules. Knowing God's word while being guided by his Holy Spirit is the only key, is the only secret to lasting change. God's word has to do it as you allow the Holy Spirit to work in your lives. In fact, New Hope, you know, we have core values here at New Hope. You've been hearing like the time, you know that. We got 10 core values. New Hope core value number 3, you know what it is? It says we believe the word of God has the power to transform lives through the work of the Holy Spirit. You want your life transformed? It's the word of God through the work of the Holy Spirit. That's how it works. See, when Ezra and the Levites read and explained God's law, it was like a free banquet to these people, many of whom had never heard the law, never read the Bible, raised as captives in a foreign land, certainly never had it explained to them in depth. I tell you one thing that I've found as a pastor, that I've seen this over and over and over again from other pastors, from curriculum that churches use and whatever. It is such a shame, that we tend to want to replace the power and the truth in God's word with something that we think will be more entertaining. That's nonsense. And we replace it with powerless gimmicks. What starving people need is food, real food. Not entertainment, not the latest self-help hype, not the latest psychobabble. What we believe is that God's word has the power to change people. Do you believe that? Are you intimately acquainted with God's word? And if you're not, are you willing to? Are you willing to get acquainted with God's word? Okay, I'm done. Everybody go... Remember I told you, though, that we'd leave the last chapter for the end? Remember that? Okay, here comes chapter 13. Chapter 13 begins, the law of the Lord is read to the people. And Nehemiah gets on his horse and returns. Back to Susa, back to Persia. 12 years later, he comes back. It's 433 BC. And when he arrives at the gates of Jerusalem and they open and he walks in the gates, he is horrified at the sight before him. He discovers that the temple is being utterly neglected. It's being staffed by completely unqualified people, some of them who are charlatans. The priests are profaning the temple by actually renting out room in it. The Levites who serve faithfully are not being paid their proper wages. Business is being conducted on the Sabbath, and the Jews are intermarrying with pagan women, becoming influenced by the pagan practices of the people around them. And so Nehemiah again moves decisively to correct the backsliding that had taken place in his absence. And eventually the people backslide again. Rinse, repeat. Rinse, repeat. See? Why am I telling you this? Why did I save it for the end? Here's why. Because even with our best intentions, and even with our best religious efforts, we can never, ever, ever, ever be who God wants us to be. You say, well, what's the point then? Here's the point. The point is the whole point of the Old Testament. You know what the whole point of the Old Testament is? It's like this. Guess what, guys? You can't do it on your own. You can't do it on your own. Even if I really, really try, yeah, you can't. So then what? The ultimate theme of the whole Old Testament. You and I need Jesus. Because only He can make us righteous and pure before God. Only He kept the law perfectly. Only He did everything right. We desperately need Him. God provided through Jesus Christ a way for our sins to be forgiven, and we can experience through Him only, not through our religious effort, but through Him only, we can for the first time perhaps experience peace and hope and joy and relationship and love and victory. And Jesus says this to you, and He says it to you here and now. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me. I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. If you haven't done that yet, could I invite you today to do that? You can do it right where you're seated. You don't have to come up here. You don't have to make some big show. You can, right where you're seated, make a commitment to Jesus Christ right here and now. Say, Lord, I give you my life. I recognize my sin. I recognize what you've done for me. I repent of my sins, and I give you my life. I submit to you as Lord and Savior, and from that moment on, you're living in a new life. Can I invite you to do that? If you don't know what that looks like or what that's all about, can I invite you to talk to me, Pastor Jesse, one of our elders, Shane or Brent, after the service? Don't leave here today. If you don't know Jesus, don't leave here today without a relationship with Him. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for all the lessons of the Old Testament. Thank you today for Nehemiah. Wow, what a powerful book. Help us to apply its principles. Help us to develop a defense against the world and against our own sin and against Satan that seeks to destroy us. Help us to humble ourselves enough to willingly confess our guilt, to make a serious commitment to you, to keep our guard against evil influences in our lives, and to know our guide thoroughly by diligently studying your word and being open to the leading of your Holy Spirit and applying those truths to our lives. Lord, thank you, most of all, that our salvation does not depend upon our efforts or our goodness or our abilities, but that salvation has been secured for us on the basis of what you and you alone have done through Jesus Christ. By his sacrifice, you paid our debt, forgiving our sins, and gave us new life so that we could be with you in a beautiful, close, intimate, personal, loving relationship forever and ever. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power. Almighty fortress, an almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
And we can take that with us. You are our fortress, our defender, our shield, our deliverer. God, we thank you for loving us so much that you would send your one and only Son, and for the hope that we have in him, for the shed blood of Jesus on the cross. 2,000 years ago, we are able to have hope today. From the very moment that we pray that simple prayer to say, Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. I invite you into my heart, and I make you my Lord and Savior. We thank you for the hope of eternity that we have in that very moment, eternity with you in that very moment. So God, as we face the rest of this weekend and the week ahead, we ask for your blessings over our families, our workplaces, our circles of influence. We ask that you bless us and keep us, make your face shine upon us, be gracious unto us, and lift up your countenance upon us and give us your peace, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. It's awesome worship with you guys. God bless you. Have a great rest of your weekend. We'll see you back here next Sunday morning at 10 a.m. God bless you.